my youth, a church that did not follow the liturgical calendar and paid no attention to the lectionary, Proverbs 31:10-31 was the scripture of choice on Mother's Day. A mother's work is hard, we were told, as our pastor interpreted the scripture. The work God has given to mothers needs to be respected by all, as it is respected in the scripture. We were informed, those of you who were godly mothers deserve our praise, ran the sermon. Those of us who were raised and are being raised by mothers who labored long and hard on our behalf need to thank God and thank these women. We were reminded. Now, this was all fine and good and true. The problem was that the same church was firmly against women in the pulpit, women in public places of power, women who rejected the traditional roles of wife, mother, and subservient member of the community, and any mention of equal rights for women. The way the text was used in my church is an example of the way preachers limit its bite, by sentimentalizing it. So I thought that was a very revealing bit of reflection, because I think all of us probably spent time on Mother's Day mornings listening to this particular scripture and having it interpreted for us thusly. So I'm kind of a myth buster in that regard. And I would like to start by saying that there's a lovely word at the very beginning of this. The word in English is capable. This wife is capable. And if you go back into the Hebrew, one of the translations of this word is warrior. Warrior woman. She's been a little bit dumbed down in some of our Bibles. But you think about these verses. This is also what's called an acrostic poem. And if you're reading it in Hebrew, every verse would start with a different letter of the alphabet. And it's a type of poetry. So what we have is a collection of verses, each one starting with a different letter of the Hebrew alphabet, to describe this vision of warrior wife, shall we say. Warrior wife. Now, back in the day when this Baptist preacher was preaching to his congregation, there were quite a few women who were working mostly in the home. And the image that we had was a woman who worked mostly in the home. But what this preacher tended to gloss over was the fact that this woman, this warrior woman, this ruler of her household, she was involved in real estate. She considered a field and she would buy it. She was a farmer. She would, with her servants, go out and plant the grapes to turn that empty land into a fruitful and prosperous vineyard. She was in manufacturing. She manufactured textiles, to be exact. She spun cloth, and she was involved in marketing because she took that cloth to the public market and sold it. And then with that money, would buy the things that her household needed. She had probably daughters-in-law, and various people within her household over which she had some dominion. She had say-so. And these people do this work, and these people do this work, and these people do this work. But it is a benevolent dominion, okay? Because think about women together. Think about holidays. Think about the work that gets done on a holiday, and it often still happens within the domain of women, and how communal they are when they prepare food, when they come together, when they present it, how communal they are when after the meal they handle cleanup and they handle organization and they try and put everything back in some semblance of what it was before everyone showed up. So there's a sense that when women come together to do the tasks of the household, there's a sense of cooperation, There's a sense of mutual respect and a sense of common goal in getting something done and everybody doing their part to work toward it. So what we have here is a picture of the warrior woman, the ideal sense of being the leader of a household. But not done with that yet, because the setting for these verses is in the book of Proverbs. And as we discussed last week, in the entire book of Proverbs from beginning to end, and today's reading comes at the very end of the book, wisdom is a woman. Okay? She's the woman who cries out in the streets, in the city gates, in the public places, places of commerce, places of legal agreement, and says, come to me. Commit to me. Be wise. Be wise in your legal dealings. Be wise in your political and your financial dealings and your market dealings. Be wise. And now we have wisdom embodied in a woman. The reason that she is referred to as a wife is because of the nature of the marriage commitment. Okay? It's a commitment of unity, of two that shall become one. And it is the deepest and most appropriate analogy for our commitment to the wisdom of God. This last chapter in this book of wisdom says, be committed to wisdom as a man to his wife, because she is the endless source of the energy and the provision and the organization and everything that you need to make your life run. Wisdom will make it happen. Now, I was reading this to my husband, and he's listening to, he goes, and he's saying, where is her husband in all of this?
Yeah.
I said, he's down in the city gates with all the rest of the guys, and he's bragging about his wife. And that's basically what men did, was they got the city gate was the gathering, kind of like coffee house, kind of like philosopher's cafe. It was the gathering for midrash study and discussion. So while there's a sense that while the women were running things, the men were divining the mysteries of the Torah to each other. Okay? And the reason they can do that is because they have a warrior back at home who knows how to run everything better than any man ever could. Okay? And because of that, there's a sense that he boasts in the marketplace. He knows. He speaks highly. And instead of a woman boasting about her children, their children boast about their mother. Okay? Wisdom is to be highly esteemed, highly respected. Okay? So, again, I invite you to take that perception of these verses, and maybe at your leisure sometime today, go back and read that last little bit of the book of Proverbs about wisdom as a courageous warrior householder who not only provides for her family, but does so in such a way that she fears no travail, she fears no change in the weather, because she is fully prepared, and who also takes in the poor and the needy, reaches her hand out to the poor. All the bases are covered. All the bases are covered. And this is the role of wisdom in our lives, to which we make a deep commitment to be one with, as a man commits to be one with his wife through marriage. here we have wisdom. And so as I was just reveling in this pericope and its different levels of understanding and interpretation, I was looking at how we apply this wondrous teaching to the objectives of peace in the world. Okay. And in order to do so, I went into the gospel. And last week we talked about this whole dynamic of peace, of wisdom being present. And earlier in the book of Proverbs, she talks about having been present at the creation of the world. Basically saying, I was there. I saw the whole thing. And then going into the other creation story from the Gospel of John, where we see Christ as the Logos, the Word of God, who was there from the beginning. So we have these two images of this presence of wisdom and word that was there at the very beginning of all things and has come to be known to us through the person of Jesus, whom we call the Christ. And so he is the bearer of this great wisdom. The personification of this great wisdom, this time not in a warrior woman, but in a humble man. A man who has tremendous power but bears it with deep humility. Okay? Remember what James said. He said, You humble yourself, and then when you come close to God in that way, God is close to you. And Jesus personified that. In his life and in his teaching. So now we have Jesus having taken his disciples, his closest followers, somewhat aside, and it said he didn't want anyone to know where he was going because he was having private teaching time with his disciples. Now, some interpreters say that it was simply a time of coming together to learn other things. But when I read the scripture itself, what I see it saying is he did not want other people to hear because he was teaching his disciples that the Son of Man must die and on the third day be raised again. So there was a specific teaching there that required a level of privacy or an elevation of learning, okay, that did not need to be part of what he was preaching to the dozens to hundreds of people who were following him from town to town or were gathering when he got into town. Okay? So you understand we have Jesus, who is a preacher, who's going from town to town. Some people are following him, some people come out when they hear he's in town, and they come out to hear him. But right now, he's demanding protection and privacy with his closest followers because he has a very hard teaching to give them. Okay. He's talking about himself, and he refers to himself as the Son of Man. This is interesting language. It's been problematic for scholars for years. And really what it comes down to is, he's just a guy. He's a guy. He's a man. He's a human. Sometimes comes down to human. Sometimes comes down to just a man. Okay? But it's used so little. It's a very specific term for just a man. However, even though Jesus refers to himself as a Son of Man, he never says, I am the Son of Man. He never makes that direct connection. He does not glorify that term in any way. And as I was reading this over and looking at the interpretation and looking at the Hebrew, I thought, what he's trying to say is that, yes, I have within me Pharisees.
Just a guy who's raising a lot of problems.
And as such, will be handed over to the authorities to meet my intended demise. Okay?
So what Jesus is teaching is, yes, you understand who I am, because this teaching all comes after the transfiguration, and it comes after the time last week we discussed when Jesus says, who do you think I am? And Peter says, you are the Messiah. And he says, good, but just don't tell anybody. Because as far as they're concerned, I'm just a son of man. I'm an Israelite. I'm a Hebrew. I'm just a man. And I'm stirring up trouble. Okay? So, we get the sense that they didn't understand what this was all about, and it would be very hard for anyone to understand what this is all about, given the Jewish understanding of death and the fact that people just don't survive death back in those days. So there's a sense of not understanding, the sense of not knowing not even knowing enough to know what questions to ask about such a statement. But you know what's on their minds. Because as they come into Capernaum, they've been talking about something, and Jesus knows what's going on because he knows the hearts of people. And he asks them. And this is an interesting approach because he doesn't say, I heard what you were saying, nor does he say, I know what's in your hearts. He simply says, so what were you guys talking about back there? Because when you ask the question, they have to confront themselves. Okay? They have to ask themselves, what were we thinking to have that conversation? And the conversation was, we're not privy to that because it's not written out, is that they were arguing over who was greater. Probably provoked by this idea that Jesus is going to die and not being able to get their heads around resurrection. And so they're going, okay, well, who's going to be the leader of this group after he's gone? Who among us is going to be the leader? Okay? And what he's saying is, and he said this in many different occasions, in many different environments, in many different ways, that in order to be the first, you have to be the last. And in order to be the most, you have to be the least. Just like James, you have to humble yourself in order to be close to God. Because God, coming down in human form, becomes the epitome of humble. The one who is willing to undergo a gruesome death in order to achieve what is to be achieved. Now, this Mark's gospel is written in Greek. Okay? All of the gospels were written primarily, first of all, in Greek, later translated to Latin, and of course other languages. But when he says that if you are to be the greatest, you have to be the servant, okay? The servant is the word poidia. After he says this, and clearly there's a child in this house running around, and he picks up this child and he puts it on his lap. And anyone reading or hearing this gospel would hear that he took a pois, a child, and put it on his lap. And there are, as we know, that nouns can have different forms. And one of the forms of pois can sound very much like poidia. So you have the sense that child and servant are very similar. And in the households of the day, they were, because servants and children had no legal rights. They had nothing to offer the household. That wonderful
children have love and devotion, but they have no rights. Okay? So the lowest of the low in this social order are servants and children. And what the teaching here is, that the pinnacle of wisdom is understanding exactly who you are, which is the servant of all. Now, in Canada, we're going through an election, a federal election, and so are we in the United States, as it so appears. It started early, it always starts early, it goes on forever. And people are jockeying for power. People are running for your votes. People are asking for money. People are putting themselves in the pockets of wealthy corporate owners in order to gain power. It's ugly out there. And these people who are seeking power, do they have a sense of having a marriage-style commitment to wisdom? Do they have a sense that by walking through the doors, whether it's Sussex or Pennsylvania Avenue, that they are the servant of all? That would probably be a really good question to ask at a debate. And I would love to hear what they have to say about that. We live in a world that gets scarier by the year. We live on a planet that is trying to balance itself out of chaos. We're living in an age of fire and flood and destruction. We're living in a time when people see a raft on the ocean as being safer than their own home. We live in a world severely out of balance, and a world in dire need of wisdom. Tomorrow, many communities and organizations will acknowledge efforts for peace. We will observe an International Day of Peace. But where is peace to be found? Where is peace to be found? Here. It's where it all starts. In the heart that has a door. Where Jesus knocks. And we open it up and say, come in. That is where peace begins. It begins when we make a level of commitment to the wisdom of God that we would make to our own spouse. And it comes when we commit ourselves to the hard daily work of doing peace. This warrior would Wisdom woman is up before the sun and doesn't go to bed till long after the sun has set. And every moment of her day is given to the work that she has come to do. The work of making peace in the divided house can be stressful and lonely, and it requires the work of both husband, wife, both mother and father. The work of building peace in the community in conflict is deep and hard and stressful.
and it requires the work of men and women together, equally, to get the job done. And the work of bringing an inkling of peace and wisdom into politics can be hard and stressful and lonely. And it requires men and women committed to each other, committed to their community, and committed to the peace and wisdom of God within, to be the creators and the workers and the vessels of peace for this creation. I would invite you, it's time to just take a deep breath, feet on the floor, hands on your knees.